On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house he enters, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." The disciples left, went into the city, and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They were saddened, and one by one they said to him, "Is it I?"
shelter the infants from the hot rays of the sun. So what he was actually telling me was that he had known me my entire life. And it was in that moment that I confessed my faith. Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Ever since then, I've been a chosen disciple and apostle to Jesus. And now he is telling us that he is instituting a service to go over Passover, a ceremony. And he also tells us that one of us here, is betraying us. I keep wondering, how can that be? How could there be a betrayer amongst his closest friends? And I also keep asking myself, is it I?
Soon after, I presented a great banquet in my home.
Since that moment, I've walked with him, talked with him, stayed with him, and agreed with him. Trying to learn as much about him and his Heavenly Father as I could. And now, to think one of us is to betray him. Surely, it is madness to think that this could be. The betrayal must be out of his mind. But I keep asking myself, is it I? Is it I?
Betrayed the one who has loved us.
beyond in Judea. End of the prayer. These men trusted me. They have elected me as their treasurer. And Jesus surely has faith in me because I have been chosen as one of the 12. Recently, I have been accused of mishandling our funds. And some have even said that Jesus' words about greed and the love of money was personally directed at me. Was it because I complained when Mary washed Jesus' feet with that expensive perfume? Maybe so. But I still think it was a complete waste of money. And if I have conspired with the chief priest, and if I have 30 pieces of silver on my person, that is my affair, not yours. I believe in Jesus, but somebody has to do something to make him assert himself as God's Messiah. He refuses to make a move. Well, I've made one. And Jesus knows. He knows what I am planning to do. He said so just a few moments ago when he washed my feet. I am Thaddeus, one of the disciples Jesus chose to be an apostle. He chose 12 of us to be the cornerstones of the new kingdom, just as the 12 tribes were the cornerstones of the old Jewish kingdom. I feel unworthy to be numbered among his apostles, but he chose me. I remember the day well. After a night of prayer, he called us to him. He gave us authority over unclean spirits and the power to heal every disease and infirmity. He then commissioned us to go and preach that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He told us to be wise as serpents, but as innocent as doves, since he was sending us out as sheep in the midst of wolves. Enough, he said, that the disciple be as his teacher, and the servant as his master. I was in Jerusalem when he gave the great invitation. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. And now, he who has come to share man's burden has a burden placed upon him. The knowledge that one of us will betray him. Who can it be? Who is this traitor? Is it the man we least suspect? Or will all of us betray him before the night is done? Philip and Peter and Judas and John and even Thaddeus. Is it I?
Thompson called me the love disciple. And I loved him as a person, but he returned my love. I was with him during his many hour trials and his hours of victory. I was with him on the Mount of Transfiguration, and he beheld his glory. Peter and I prepared the upper room for the Passover celebration tonight because he considered us to be his most intimate inner circle. It was I who he talked to about his help in Nicodemus when he spoke those wonderful words. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever should believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Someday I hope to write down some of his many sayings and wonderful deeds, so that others may read this and know that he is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing in him, they may have life in his name. But now he has said that one of us is a betrayer. I cannot believe this, yet it must be true of him that I've said it. Who could it be? Surely not my brother James, or Andrew, or Peter. Is it John, the beloved disciple?
Simon Zelotes. Before Jesus called me, I was a part of a group of bloodthirsty, hot-headed revolutionaries known as zealots. We thought nothing about using the tools of armed insurrection to crush Rome. We had wanted nothing more than to crush them under our heels. We thought we were positive that we were restoring the ancient glory of Israel as in the days of Solomon and David. But it was Jesus who taught me of a different kind of kingdom. A kingdom of the heart where God reigns supreme. And when I heard this, I could only change. I had to change my mind, change my allegiance. I had to love as he loved and to serve as he served. I would follow him. It was he who taught me that the only true and lasting and sincere conquest was the conquest. I have given him my highest loyalty, my deepest devotion. I have, in military terms, surrendered to him unconditionally and completely. But I will tell you this, my surrender has not imprisoned me. It has, in fact, set me free. I am no longer afraid of Rome. I do not fear Rome. Rome is mighty, but God is almighty. Yet, he tells us that there's a spiritual Roman amongst us, one who would use force to do that which only love can accomplish. Who could it be? Is it the big fisherman or his brother? Is it Matthew, the tax collector? I'm the only former zealot here. Is it I? Is it I?
Thank you.
nothing. But at your word, I will let down the nets. We caught so many fish that we had to call the men in the boats beside us to help us get a catch to shore. When I reached the shore, I fell down at Jesus' feet and I cried out, "Depart from me, O Master, for I am a sinful man." But he told us thereafter that we would be fishing for men. In fact, he changed my name from Simon to Peter, which means the rock. And when I confessed him as the Christ, the Son of God, he said that he would build his church on me, the rock. But a moment later, when I protested about his going to Jerusalem to die at the hands of evil men, he rebuked me and said, "Get behind me, Satan." So I am a mixture of good and evil, of godliness and devilishness. Tonight, when he said that one of us would betray him, I promised to follow him even unto death. But he warned me before the cock crows twice, "You will deny me three times." Even though the others call me the big fisherman, before Jesus, I feel small and unsure and unworthy. Will I deny him before the rooster crows? And if I do, what will he do? Will he deny me? Will he close the doors of the kingdom to me? Will he disown me? Was he referring to me when he said, "One of you will betray me"? If I knew who the scoundrel was, I'd pierce his heart with this knife that I hold in my hand. But maybe it would be my own heart. God grant me that it would not be so. Yet I keep wondering and saying to myself, "Is it I, Lord?"